First item on the agenda will be proclamation for Giving Tuesday. How are you this morning?
Doing well.
This proclamation reads as follows. Whereas Giving Tuesday is a movement to celebrate action and provide motivation for people to give to charitable causes and community needs that culminate with a global day of giving on December 2nd, 2014. And whereas this powerful movement directs the spirit of the holiday giving season to focus more on doing good things for communities and to be less focused on consumerism by highlighting areas of need and services that affect overall well-being. And whereas after Black Friday and Cyber Monday, Giving Tuesday provides a time whereby people can become engaged and resolved to help with issues such as poverty, disease, hunger, animal shelters, and many other causes by giving hope, help, time, and donations. And whereas becoming part of such a tremendous action plan is something everyone can take pride in while emphasizing the process of helping, contributing, and embracing the true meaning of the holiday season. Now therefore, I, Glenn Barham, Mayor of Wichita Falls, do hereby proclaim December 2nd, 2014 as Giving Tuesday Day in Wichita Falls, and I encourage all citizens to help improve our community, become part of the movement to give back while celebrating the great American tradition of generosity and emphasizing the most meaningful gift of commitment in working together and making a difference locally and globally. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand and caused to be affixed the great seal of the city of Wichita Falls, Glenn Barham, Mayor, December 1st, 2014. Congratulations. And Eric wants a couple of pictures. Would you like to say a few words? If you would, right here, please.
On behalf of Habitat for Humanity here in Wichita Falls, I want to thank you for the proclamation and just encourage everybody to remember all the nonprofits in our community who have given so much throughout the year and to take this opportunity to give back, whether it's time or monetary donations. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations. Come on up, Pam. Sure. Bring the little one as well. The more the merrier. Kevin?
Mayor and Council, it is our pleasure to introduce Pam Birch as the December Employee of the Month. Pam is the Executive Secretary in the City Manager's Office. She was initially hired by the City in February of 2010 for the clerical pool and then began full-time employment as an Administrative Clerk for Engineering in August of 2010. She was promoted to Administrative Secretary for Public Works in January of 2011. And then in March of 2013, we stole her away from Public Works and promoted her to the Executive Secretary position in the City Manager's Office. She also works part-time as an impact usher, working hockey games and concerts and other events. I know that you are familiar with some of the things that Pam does because she does provide administrative support to you, Mayor, and to the Council with your meeting schedules and travel and other administrative assistance. But in addition to that, she also provides extensive administrative support to the City Manager and to the Assistant City Managers. She provides a lot of support in preparation of your bi-monthly City Council agenda packets. She provides research assistance for various projects and assistance in preparation of the annual budget for the City Manager's Office and the Mayor and Council Office. In addition, Pam is also very instrumental in the annual Arts Commission grant application process, and she handles the majority of that process, including compilation of the applications and preparing the performance agreements and the payment authorizations for each of the organizations. Of course, one of the most crucial aspects of her job is her interaction with the public. And as you can imagine, as the secretary to the city manager, she is the person that many people often have the first contact with when they call the city. She handles all the calls, whether they're complaints or just questions and inquiries. She handles all of those in a very professional, calm, and courteous manner. And so even in the most trying of circumstances at times, she represents the city extraordinarily well. In summary, Pam's pleasant personality, her professionalism, and her willingness to take on new assignments when asked make her a truly valuable asset to our team and a pleasure to work with. Pam's hobbies include scrapbooking, walking, going to the movies, and concerts, but her greatest joy is spending time with her family and friends. She has two adult children, daughter Ashley, who is here with us today, her son Brandon, and her 4.5-year-old granddaughter Sydney, who is also here with us today. In closing, Pam is greatly deserving of recognition as Employee of the Month. She's a great asset to the city and an outstanding representative of the mayor and the city council, the city manager's office, and the city as a whole. Congratulations to Pam as Employee of the Month.
Ashley, you want to help me present this to your grandmother? That's okay. Pam, it's my pleasure to present this plaque naming you as Employee of the Month for the December 2014. Pam does a great job, and probably the best thing she does very handily is provide chocolate for the chocolate fiend that is always in the office. So Pam, we appreciate the work that you do. I know it's not easy. Sometimes we put a lot of demands on you, but you handle them all very professionally and do it with a smile on your face every time. Congratulations. There's the plaque. He wants a picture. Darren, you coming down?
I'm high maintenance. So
okay. Along with the plaque, we have a letter of congratulations. Also, there is a gift card and a restaurant letter in here, as well as a small check. Congratulations. Thank you. You want to say a few words? Right there.
I just want to say it's been a pleasure working for the council, the city staff, and for the citizens of Wichita Falls.
Thank you, Pam. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Have a good day. Next item on the agenda will be comments from the public.
Good morning. We have one person signed up to speak today. That's David Brock, and he would like to speak on the topic of cops.
Name and address for the record, please, sir.
My name is David Brock, 320 Hilltop, Wichita Falls. I will need to read my statement today because chemo has left me unable to carry on a chain of thought off the cuff. Now, I have been told to shut up by every mayor since I was 18 except the country gentleman who beat Kay Yeager. So while this is about your brothers in blue, Mayor, please allow me the respect to finish my statement without interrupting, and I will be more than glad to answer any questions when I am finished. I have come here today to talk about bad cops who don't know the law, don't want to do their jobs. The problem runs the gamut of cops beating up innocent people, to lying in their official reports, to refusing to do their job, or not knowing the law, or trying to make it up as they go along. I know most of you know about McDowell and McCann beating me up. They did not like what I said when I did not like what I had to say, and then lying about it in their reports. A jury found me not guilty of interfering with them, as they claimed in their report, after hearing the tape of what really happened that night. But this is not about this. Now, I have been helping Georgiana Punell with a tenant who has only paid $648 all year. She lives at 810 Irene Lane. The police have refused to enforce the law she has broken on 904, 908, and 1000 Irene. She has four dead horses, one on 904 and three on 1000 Irene, and was told to remove them by animal control, but to date she has done nothing, even though we left the gate unlocked and open for several days. I have called the police many times out there, and they have done nothing. I have filed a complaint against Officer Cook and Jones, yet nobody has contacted me. A week ago Saturday, I called for help when Barbara Barnes threatened to kill me and my pets. And when Cook and Jones came out, Cook asked me if I had gotten her evicted out of 810 Irene yet, and I said no. He then said he was not going to do anything until she was evicted. I told him that was a separate lot and it did not matter, and he replied it does to me, and he got in his car and left. That was recorded on tape of Officer Jones because I asked him to turn his recorder on. I did later talk to a supervisor and quoted him the law, but he said he could not help me and told me to call the front desk, which I did. Then on Sunday night, someone was shooting at our houses at 9:30 p.m., and I called it in. On Sunday afternoon, Georgiana Pudenell came to me and asked if I had seen the donkey. We were looking after it for my step-granddaughter, and we found it dead, shot twice. I tried to call it in and make a report, and was told to call animal control. If Jones and Cook had done their job on Saturday and talked to her, the animals might be alive. I found my cat dead, also shot, on Wednesday afternoon. This has been ongoing since October 14th. Once when I called an officer, and I want to apologize to her up front because I don't know her name or how to pronounce it. I think it's Tofty. She said she was not going to take reports for damage done at 904, 908, or 1000 Irene because she had seen Mrs. Barnes on that property. I showed her the contract for 18 Irene and tried to show her records from the appraisal district showing that there were separate legal lots, and she said she would only accept a court order, and when I tried to show her a copy of the law, she said she would not read it because it was a copy. It does not matter that Ms. Barnes was on the other property before. She does not own it and has no legal claim to it. If we want her off, she has to get off. The officer said she had a verbal agreement, but Texas law does not allow verbal agreements on land. All deals having to do with land must be in writing. In 2013, the contract was rescinded under Chapter 5.064 of the Texas Property Code, and the other lots are covered under Chapter 93 of the Property Code because they are commercial real estate. Ms. Barnes has been given free legal help from Kyle Counts of West Texas Legal Aid, even though she has bragged to us about how much money she makes. I believe this is because I reported Mr. Counts when he took on the case of Debbie Maddox. She was a waitress at a bar he was having an affair with and was wanted by the police. He is now helping Ms. Barnes for retaliation and has delayed things because he was counting on Judge Sons not knowing what rescission meant. The rescission of the contract in Chapter 5.64 for the property meant. It means that we have had a delay in getting Mrs. Barnes off the property. We are working through the delay, but the cops need to step up to stop Mrs. Barnes' illegal activity on the other lots, and therefore I am asking for your help today.
Thank you, Mr. Brock. I was informed by the police chief this morning that you've talked to him. Is that correct?
And I've talked to several people, sir. Yes,
he's going to be looking into this, and he'll get back with us with some information on what the situation is.
I would appreciate if somebody could get back to me because I'm kind of left in the dark.
He'll do that as well.
All right.
Thank you.
Mayor, Council, the only complaint I got, and I received it yesterday, was on the shooting of the donkey. So all the other civil action that he's talking about, I'm not aware of.
Okay. Thank you. Any others, Tracy? Okay. Darren?
Good morning, Mayor and Council members. Your consent agenda this morning includes the minutes from your November 18th, 2014 meeting, as well as a resolution authorizing the purchase of 2,430 rollout refuse carts through the Houston-Galveston Area Council of Governments Cooperative Purchasing Program from Schaefer Systems International in the amount of $135,297.50, a resolution awarding professional services agreement to Biggs & Matthews Environmental Incorporated for engineering services for the City of Wichita Falls landfill in the amount of $78,000, and the last resolution will award a bid and contract for the 2015 sanitation parking lot rehabilitation project. This is phase four of that project, to Freeman Paving LLC, the amount of $96,778.50. And lastly, you'll receive the minutes from the Zoning Board of Adjustment and Traffic Safety Commission.
Thank you. Is there a desire to remove anything from the consent agenda to the regular agenda? Being none, is there a motion to accept as presented?
So moved.
Second. Have a motion and a second to accept the consent agenda as presented. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
First item on your regular agenda is 8A, which is an ordinance that would amend Section 106-186 of the City's Code of Ordinances to establish a modified water conservation drought contingency rules and providing for codification. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Russell?
Mayor and Council, I know we're all becoming way too familiar with our water conservation drought contingency plan. As the drought continues to linger and we're in unprecedented drought conditions here in the city of Wichita Falls, you're all well aware of the fact that we amended that drought ordinance numerous times throughout this last year as we developed additional stages for water conservation measures to extend our water supply. The latest revision came on the October 21st council meeting, and it was at the at council meeting where, at the request of a car wash owner, the provision to suspend use of potable water for washing of vehicles when the lake levels reach 20%, that provision was suspended. The enforcement of that provision was suspended until after February 1st. Obviously, that was approved at the 21st council meeting. Staff has now been instructed to revise the ordinance again to remove that section of the ordinance in its entirety. That, in essence, would allow the use of potable water or drinking water up to the point where the city's lakes were completely empty or out of water. It's staff's responsibility, from our perspective, that we need to extend the water supply, and it's our responsibility to make recommendations to you as to how to extend that water supply to protect the health, safety, and welfare of the public to the fullest extent possible. Some factors that are bullet items in your backup agenda there, and I'll just touch on those briefly, and then I'll be glad to answer any questions, is car washes consume roughly approximately 27 million gallons of water per year in the city. That's roughly enough water to supply at least 240 homes for a year, as well as supply United Regional Hospital and other health care facilities for well over a year. I know we've heard a lot of discussion about the fact that we have our reuse project online now, and a lot of the water that the car washes are using is returned to us. That's true. A good percentage of that water does come back to the reuse system. But of the water that is consumed, more than half of that is still coming from the lakes. So just because the DPR is online doesn't mean car washes aren't impacting the supply of the lakes. The International Car Wash Association has issued studies that tell us that, depending on the type of car washes will lose anywhere from roughly 17% to 33% of the water they consume by carry out and evaporation. The Stage 5 restrictions were adopted by the Water Resources Commission and the staff, and we've made several concessions throughout the development of those rules and regulations to accommodate and lessen the impact on car wash industry as much as possible. The current ordinance as written is not out of the norm. There are numerous other cities that eliminate the use of drinking water for washing of vehicles at some point in their ordinance. And car wash owners do have options and choices. They do have the option to secure an alternate water supply. And it's my understanding that 4 car washes in town have already made that accommodation. From staff's perspective, washing of vehicles and using drinking water to wash vehicles at some point needs to be eliminated in a drought. It is a discretionary, non-essential water use, and staff feels that 20% is the appropriate level to remove that limitation. If not 20%, then we as a council and staff need to decide when that is appropriate, if at all. You know, if you ask me if I think the lakes are going to hit 20%, my response to you would be, I don't think that they will. I think with the most recent rain, I think it's unlikely that we'll hit 20% in the reservoirs. I do know that if we do hit 20%, based on where we stand today, it's likely that 20% would occur toward the end of spring, and that means we didn't get the spring rains, and that means we're looking at a long, hot, dry summer ahead of us. And I think it's appropriate that we should leave this limitation in the ordinance so that we can extend that water supply through those hot summer months. And with that, I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Any questions from council? Anetta?
So when we took the vote in October and you said the car wash owner approved 20% was the cutoff for the car washes, was the person speaking for just them, or were they speaking for all the car washes?
We only met with one car wash owner, counselor, and I assume it was for that car wash owner.
And they agreed that 20% was what they we would cut off the car washes at 20%.
Right.
They agreed for that.
Move the enforcement of that provision out until February 1st. That's correct.
Counselor, just to add to what Russell said, and may go toward your question as well, back when the Water Resources Commission, they were meeting, there were some task force meetings and a meeting with the Car Wash Association or the Car Wash Group in town, so it included more than the one car wash, and that was specifically discussed, correct?
Right.
In fact, I think the question was asked, at what point do you, as car wash owners, think it's appropriate to eliminate the use of potable water for car washing? And 20% was what was thrown out.
Was that thrown out before the reuse project?
Yes, the meetings were before that, but it's also important to note regarding the reuse project that project actually came online later than we thought and planned for. If you recall, we were hoping for a May or June start date, and TCEQ required additional testing, so that actually delayed the direct potable reuse situation and actually worsened the water status.
So everybody in that task force at that day agreed that 20% the car washes would shut down. Even the council liaison who was in there, everybody agreed to that, right?
The car washes that were in attendance agreed.
Everybody agreed. Okay.
Clarify on that. Not now. In a minute, you can clarify that in a minute, Jim.
Darren, can you tell me who was the council liaison in there at that time?
I'm not sure if the council liaison was in that meeting. The person sitting here, I think, that was the council liaison could probably better answer that question.
Okay.
Tim?
I was council liaison at the time. I did have reservations about it. I did not make that meeting, with the meeting with the car washes or the other. I just know that 20% was a number that was pushed, and I don't know that it was debated, because at the time we didn't know what was going on. I mean, we really didn't have any idea, you know, where we were going to go, if the project was going to happen. I think we were doing the most conservative thing we could do, and looking at that, and I think most of us accept what staff says a lot of the times, and we've agreed many, many times with you on most of the stuff that recommendations you make. But at some point, when we get through this, we look at it and we go, you know, the things have changed, things are different. We've made up some of the money with some of the savings. We've had some new projects come on with the big major water users. We've got some other ones coming up. We've got a lot of people that have stepped up with conservation efforts. And so with me, it just slowly started turning. But Annetta, to your question, I don't, it's kind of hard when you say, and you sit in a meeting and say, this is what we're going to do, what kind of do you want to do it? And the car wash owners go, well, we really don't want to do this, but since this is going to happen, and that's what happens when the government says, we're going to do this, we need this to happen, what do you want? And I think if they said no, I think it still would have come out at 20%, because it was going to happen one way or the other. It's kind of like when we did the smoking ordinance. You know, it's like, well, this is going to happen whether, and they eventually just capitulated and said, okay, just make it happen, because we don't want to fight anymore, because we know it's going to come back around again. And so sometimes I think people get a little overzealous, and I think there's some people have some, there's probably some bias somewhere, but there's logical reasons for why. Yes, you can say this is 27 million, yes, they return it, it can do this, but you can also look at other reasons why, and I'm looking at the other side of it. And now that we're in a different situation, we're there. I agree with Russell, and probably 99% of what he does, I think he does outstanding work, and I think the city is really blessed to have him and the staff and what they do. I just think at this point, as a unity standpoint, that we don't need to be looking at one industry and saying, well, at the end of the 4 years worth, when we run out of water, because we have Lake Kemp and that stuff's all working, and Russell's staff's doing a great job, that their 13 whatever million gallons net that they use is 4 days later it's dry. We're going dry 4 days later. It's just not in my scheme of things. I'm like, they're not the reason why. I understand that it can seem like it's discretionary, non-discretionary, that it can seem like it's a waste, it can do it, but in reality, they're a part of this business community, and in my heart of hearts, I cannot see the government stepping in and saying, you need to make this decision, government. No. Why don't we let them do it and let the consumers and the business consumers make that final decision and say, we know we need to cut back on water. We know we need to conserve. This stuff has been brought up. People will make the decision to go there or not. I don't go there as much as I used to. I know other businesses will cut back. I know their revenue has already dropped. I know the number of people going through has already dropped. It is the winter time. That does happen. But I just, from a business standpoint, I just can't, from a government standpoint, I can't be on a government that says, nope, we're going to pick, you guys don't get to win here. And there's a lot more cost when you add in this stuff. And I'm looking forward to the car wash stuff. Because when you start adding in the price of water, which is 5 to 6-fold what city water is, some of these guys aren't going to be able to make it. And there's a lot of expense, and there's a lot of other stuff that goes into it that was not brought up when we did this. And I look forward to hearing what the car wash representative has to say.
Any other comments from council?
I'd like to make a comment. For me, you know, we've debated this, and for those of us on the inside who actually, you know, look at these issues intimately and really go over the details, you know, a lot of the general public, this may be new to them that we're actually looking at this, and I understand that. And, you know, car wash owners and business owners and people who have really looked at this issue have really, I think, chewed this up and just, you know, for me personally, you know, we have already decided stage five, and then we've made some changes to it as we moved along. And you know, I've heard the argument of, well, this has been decided. You know, these things have, you know, the Resources Commission has made the recommendations. Council voted on the you know, the far majority of those recommendations are what was implemented. And so this has been decided. We don't need to look at this again. But for me, I can't go along with that argument of just, you know, it's been decided. I think, you know, we're in uncharted territory in a lot of these things. We're doing things that, you know, no city has had to do before with our reuse project. We're on the forefront. So I think it's imperative for us to continue to look at things. And if we decide at some point that, you know what, I don't think that's exactly right, or we can change that, I think it's fair to consider that and to do so if it's the right decision. You know, if it's going to be a decision that we're flip-flopping and it's going to detrimentally affect businesses or people in an unfair way, then I don't think we should do that. But if it's an issue that it's fair to relook at, I don't think the argument of it's already been decided should be the main thing that we consider. And to some of the points, you know, as any lawyer should, I've looked at both sides of this issue. Just like Tim said, you know, previously I was more neutral. You know, we accepted the stage five recommendations. I'm very happy with them. But as I begun to look more in the details of this particular issue, my gut check, not just looking at the facts, but my gut check tells me I don't like the equity in this particular provision. You know, we do have the reuse project, the direct and indirect, and I agree with Darren that, you know, we've known for a year or more that, you know, we were moving towards the direct reuse project and the indirect. And so, you know, with this in mind, as these, you know, these ordinances were created over that year, last 2 years, you know, we've known about this. But at the same time, I do still think there's been somewhat of a paradigm shift in the water that we're getting back. And I think that helps this argument. I really do. The fact that PPG and Howmet, we've got the 4A funds that are going to boost their reuse projects out there. PPG, 250 to 300,000 gallons per day. Howmet, maybe up to 50,000 per day. That's not our complete salvation, but I think those help. And I think those are factors that we should consider in this particular decision. I know some of the car washes have already, you know, brought in tanks and spent a lot of money and done their own recycling projects. You know, me personally, I don't know any of the car wash owners on a personal level. I've gotten to know them through this process. I've never met with any of them individually. That has nothing to do with my decision making. For me, it's been, you know, just pouring over these the facts and the figures and all that, and coming to the conclusion that I don't like the provision as it's written, and I'm in agreement with considering a revision of it and backing off and not being so heavy-handed with this particular industry. You know, I worry about the detriment effect to the local economy in the long term, the personal economies of each family who, you know, may lose a job. And I understand, you know, you can make the argument that these aren't high-paying jobs. You know, these are closer to the lower end on your average employee there at that particular industry, but it still affects their personal economy, whether it's an 18-year-old kid or an older person who may have a family. Also, the economies of the business owners, the personal economies. I'm concerned about a future precedent. You know, we do have ordinances around the state that, you know, similar provisions where you have these types of restrictions, but I worry about the precedent of a particular industry being singled out and what that looks like 5, 10, 15 years down the road. And I've heard from numerous business owners who've told me, please vote to relax the restrictions on the car washes. And that's the far majority of what I've heard recently since this issue has resurfaced. You know, I look forward to hearing, you know, now that this is broadcast today and it's going to be in the paper and, you know, the next few weeks, I do look forward to hearing back from people. I don't know if we're going to take a vote today or what's going to happen, but that's the far majority of the feedback I've heard. I'm not going to steal any more time, but that's just leading through my thought process of being more neutral on this particular issue and then looking at it deeper now that we're on the cusp of it. And, you know, I feel strongly about just reconsidering that.
Thank you, Ben. Anybody from council? Okay. Thank you, Russell.
Russell, Ryan? What's the total savings you think we're going to get out of PPG with their project we're doing in Howmatt? Have we added all that up to estimate annual savings?
I haven't, Councilor Hooker, but it's roughly 250,000 gallons per day. We're going to use all of the effluent from the Northside Wastewater Treatment Plant for their use. So it's several hundred million gallons or so.
Okay. And what's your estimate on the annual use for the car washes?
27 million gallons total.
Okay.
Yep.
And that's just PPG. That doesn't count Howmatt?
That's right.
Okay.
Anybody else up here? Okay. From the audience. Name and address for the record, please, Mike.
Mike Stolt, 5114 Crown Ridge Drive. Mayor, Council, thank you. As I said, my name is Mike Stolt, and my family owns Stadium Car Wash in the corner of Barnett and Southwest Parkway. We've had it for about 10 years. Great job. Great business, great industry. I'd highly recommend it to anyone. As a matter of fact, if you're so inclined, it might be a good time to make an offer on a car wash in Wichita Falls. Today, I represent myself and specifically five other family-owned and operated car washes. While I know Larry and Jim well, respect them greatly, All-American is a different market, different product. And no car wash has done more for the industry and for the city during this drought than All-American. But I'm here today because the word on the street is that it's only All-American that is concerned about the restrictions under which we now operate. The mom and pops are extremely concerned. We are very concerned that 28.5% of our businesses have been taken by the government by closing us 2 days a week. We're extremely concerned, and I brought it up several times, that someday the meth heads in North Texas and Southern Oklahoma will realize that the city of Wichita Falls requires that about a dozen cash businesses close every Saturday night at midnight. And they'll find those owners up there with their keys in their hands in the dark, normally alone. That's risky, it's dangerous, and when somebody gets shot during a robbery, we're going to look at that and say we should have seen that coming. We're very, very concerned, of course, at the prospect of January 31st or any date after that we hit 20%. The rest of our businesses will be closed. 100% will be taken by the government. As Mr. Hoover said, that doesn't happen here. That happens in Venezuela and Russia and maybe New York City, but not here. We're very concerned about all of this. What is disconcerting to us all is that it does not have to be this way. It should not be this way for many, many different reasons. Three continue to roll around in my head personally. My business, which is valued by hundreds, maybe thousands of citizens, many businesses, Texas Railroad Commission, the city police, the oil and gas industry, the list goes on and on and on. My business has been deemed by the government as less essential to this community than the Wichita Falls Strip Club. And I think it's been lost in time and lost in the fog that we are not being closed because of how much water we use. We are not, because we don't use that much. Most of us are nowhere near the top 100 business users. We're being closed because the government or a government-appointed entity decided for the citizens and for all the businesses what is essential and what is not essential. They picked winners and losers. What's also very disconcerting to me is that I've been in many meetings and I've seen and I've heard why I and other owners were picked as losers. Perception. You can see our water, and that's a direct quote. Whereas other businesses, restaurants, hotels, laundry facilities, bars, the list goes on and on, most of that water is used behind closed doors. And a very vocal, very well-meaning, yet ill-informed minority put pressure on the city council and the mayor to close car washes. What they do not know, or what they did not know, is that car washes clean with high pressure, not high volume. The magic is in the tip. People have always been amazed at how low my water use is, at how low my water bill is. That's exactly the reason that most cities in the United States and the entire state of California do not restrict car washes. In their drought plans, they encourage professional car washing, and they, in some cases, mandate that you will use a professional car wash to save money. The third thing that is disconcerting about the restrictions is that closing car washes 2 days a week is not effective. It does not work. It does not move the needle. If you took all of the water that all of the car washes use, to include both locations at All American Super Car Wash, we use less than 0.25% of daily use. When we talk gallons, it sounds like a lot. When we talk daily use, it sounds like a lot. Less than 0.25% of daily use. If someone actually looked, which I think we should with restrictions in place, actually looked at what 2 days a week saves, the number would be imperceptible, hardly worth all this trouble, hardly worth the cost to our economy, and hardly worth the risk on Saturday night. I think decisions like this are normally made based on one of three things: emotion, a thorough cost-benefit analysis, or principle. I feel, and the other car wash owners feel, that we were easy targets in an emotionally charged, almost panicked time. We were easy targets because we were the most visible restriction that could be put into place. We were easy targets because we do not have deep corporate pockets with which to defend ourselves. We were easy targets because it didn't cost the city a dime. We are one of the few services businesses that do not take money from the hands of our citizens and move them into the city coffers with sales tax. We do continue to pay property taxes. Mine went up this year. If the decision had been made on a thorough cost-benefit analysis, I'm convinced, personally, we wouldn't have been closed a day. If the decision had been made based on principle, putting a bullet in the head of an industry wouldn't have garnered a second thought, especially as the business publicly professes undying support for business, big and small, and especially when the industry in question is doing backflips to help, to invest, to cooperate, to educate, to innovate. We have worked tirelessly to make ourselves even more lean and even more efficient than we already were. If it had been made based on principle, you would have snapped to the thought on day one, okay, how do we help these small businesses survive this tough time along with the rest of the community? Well, it hasn't been together, but we have all worked. The car washes, as I said, have invested. We've educated. We've looked for ways to be more, even more efficient. The city, of course, has worked tirelessly, and it has worked. The education program that you've got has worked all over the city, but we see it at our car washes. On the days that we are open, our car washes have fallen off naturally when people have chosen to wash fewer times, which is the way it should and could have been from the beginning. It would have naturally fallen off. Also, because of the city and your forethought and your tireless efforts and your investment, we have a reuse program. So what little we still do use, 66% of it approximately, is not lost. It's recaptured and reused. As was said earlier, it's a different landscape, as Mr. Engel said. It's a different landscape now than it was when the restrictions were first instituted. Maybe now it's time to look at it again in this new landscape and remove those restrictions and give back the 28.5% of our businesses that you hold in your hands. And maybe it's time to stop the risky midnight closings. Maybe it's time to remove all restrictions and put everyone back on the same team so that we can all work toward that common goal together and without all this animus. I'd be glad to take any questions that you might have. If I can't answer them, which may be the case, I'll research it or pass it off to one of the other car wash owners in the room.
Tim?
One question for you, Mike, maybe two. When it was first presented, I think it was like, well, they can find another potable source. Well, potable source obviously is well water, and I was thinking, well, you know, I guess you could wash a car with very salty water, and then, but apparently, for good car washes and for sprayless, can you talk to me about the extra cost that was not added in when I don't think we made this decision?
You're right, sir, and I can't speak to the exact cost because I personally have held off on all of that. I've researched it and tried to learn as others do it, but mainly I've held off in principle. But I have, one of the things I have learned from others is that you cannot put well water, depending on the source. If you put highly salinated water on a car, it'll damage the paint and you're gonna have to repaint it. And that's happened here in this process. So. It's not just two big black tanks and a pad of concrete and some PVC pipe. You have to put in filtration systems and you have to invest many thousands of dollars to make that work. And it's easy, appreciate the question, but it is easy to get into the weeds of those options and get away from the principle of, now we're doing all this to save how much, and in the big scheme of things, it's less than 0.25%, and possibly even, well, 66% less of that. That's why I keep going away from that in general and going back to the principle of why are we doing this again, and aren't we going to pass this on to the consumer, and isn't that going to ripple through the community and take money out of somebody else's pocket in this community? Because there's a finite amount of money, and upping our prices, that just takes the money from another businessman that would have gotten that dollar. Instead, they put it in my car wash. Did I answer your question, Mr. Engel?
Annetta?
So, sir, so if the restrictions aren't lifted, will your business close or will you haul in water to keep your car wash open?
I will close.
You will close, and we will lose the tax base.
Yes, ma'am, and, okay. And if you don't mind, I'll expand on that question, that answer, just a little bit, because
go
you're
ahead.
Looking at the impact of my closure. While I do not have a large employee base, I'm a family-owned and operated car wash. One of my employees is 12, and she's not all that great, but I still claim her. I buy my chemicals from J Systems. These are all local. IMC Waste cleans out my grip traps. Dale Mercury is my local electrician. Billy Link is my local plumber. David Bates does any construction and concrete I might need. Julian, I forgot his last name, repairs my brick. McKenna makes my hoses and fittings. I frequent Home Depot and Lowe's for parts. I buy salt at Sam's, work boots at Cavender's, and gloves at O'Reilly's. I buy air compressors at Tractor Supply and belt pumps at AutoZone. My taxes are done by Brandon Schultz. My business banking is at Wells Fargo, at United. AT&T provides my phone and internet, and First Bank here locally holds my mortgage. We talk a lot about employees. That money ripples through our community over and over and over and over. I think the number is every dollar spent, you see it seven times. I'm not sure if that's accurate or not, but we do talk a lot about employees and what would happen if we closed. It would ripple through our community and through our business community. Every car wash owner has a similar list just like that, and maybe even longer and maybe even more elaborate, but it would have a great impact if we closed.
Any other questions of Mr. Stolt? Thank you, Mike.
Thank you for your time.
Come on up, David. Name and address for the record.
David Brock, 320 Hilltop. And this subject brought me here today. I used to own a little coin-operated car wash in Sunnyside. And I had to close it down because of the vandalism and break-ins that occurred when we weren't open or when there was no one around. And that's going to happen here. I bet you that they never got more than $10 in all the times that they broke in quarters. But that was not the damage. It was the timers, the stuff that they cut when they would try to cut the hoses to get the brass fittings off of it while we were closed. If you close these businesses, you're going to have not forget the water, just the cost to try to get them back up and running when you let them reopen is going to be unreasonable. You know, the timers that they kept tearing up, when there was, I would take the money boxes out and they would still break in the timers and tear them up. Far exceeded the cost of any quarters they ever got. Probably far, and finally I closed it. I just could not afford to keep fixing things because people saw us as an easy target of being sitting there closed up and dark at night. And you're going to have the same thing happen if you make car washes close up in Wichita Falls. You're going to have to put extra police officers patrolling those areas. You're going to have a higher amount of vandalism and damage. I know firsthand I closed my business because of the damage. Not because I lost money, and the water wasn't even an issue back then, but when you close up a business and board up a business and leave it sitting there, if it lasts for any length of time, it's going to be the vandals, the copper thieves, the metal thieves, they're going to find those businesses, and they're going to destroy them. And I think we've all seen, you know, just look at the Day and Night Grocery, how many times that place was broken into for them to steal. They got to where they were stealing the grid that held up the drop ceiling to find metal to sell. It's going to happen the same to these businesses. And everybody's looking at the water, but I just wanted to come today because having personally lost a business to vandalism and to damage, I want y'all to consider that as well as you consider this topic, that you're not just looking at how much the cost of losing the water or maybe losing the sales. You're looking at the cost of having to repair these things after they sit vacant for any length of time, to the damage that these drug heads that are out here in our community, and we all know they're there, are going to do to these businesses because the fittings are brass or copper, a lot of them. The piping is copper most of the time. It's got to be high pressure. And the money boxes are very expensive. And even if they have no money, they still, those guys can't get it through their head that that coin slot doesn't mean there's money behind it. The money never stays in the changer. It falls to a box in the bottom. But those guys never could figure out that no matter how many times they tore those changers out, there was nothing behind them. And so I just wanted to come today to add that perspective that it's more than just how much water we're going to save and the cost of these businesses. It's the cost of the vandalism and damage that will occur if they sit vacant for any length of time.
Okay. Thank you, David.
Jim Cadott, 2609 Cherokee Street, Wichita Falls, Texas. I just want to clarify one issue. Ms. Pope, you asked the question, did the car washes accept the 20%? It was February 11th of this year that we had the meeting that we were called to. The 20% number was not provided by the car washes. In fact, when Mr. Ferguson, who was a member of the Water Resource Commission, asked the question, well, at what point do we shut it off? Mr. Hooker, Councilman Hooker, was at that meeting. And actually, I said, you know, who knows? 5-10%, we don't know that number. But when one side of the table holds a hammer, it's not really a compromise. We've accepted what we've accepted because we've had to do that along the way to stay open. We didn't know the numbers. We've spent, All American has spent $60,000. Many of the others you've heard have spent a tremendous amount of money to set up tanks. What we are all discovering through this process, which is new to us because this is all new, is that the cost of hauling in and bringing that water far exceeds. You've seen it yourself as a city and a city-run business. The water park made $1,400 when many people said, I can't believe that. I don't believe that number. They're making more money than that. I said, I believe it immediately because they hauled water. And if you haul water, you're looking at break even at best. Many of us are looking at losses. And it's hard for us to do that. We don't have the pockets of a city. We don't have the pockets of a major corporation. And we're finding that those numbers, we can't support those numbers. So I wanted to clarify that we did not agree. We accept it. And there's a whole difference when there's power on one side of the table. Thank you.
So I have a question for you. So if the regulation is not lifted, if the restrictions aren't lifted, what are you going to do? Are you going to modify? Or are you going to close? What are you going to do?
To be honest with you, we have worked to develop different parts of our business. It's a benefit, and gosh, I mean, it is life-saving for us that we have lube centers, we have mechanic shops, we've opened All American Customs. We've done these things to try to diversify our business while also cutting our water usage by over 40% in the last 3 years. You know, we have led the way. We have bled with our hearts, with our pocketbooks, with our efforts to do this and following the city's guideline. And I think that we have missed the boat to be united together in this. You know, what you're doing as a city and as a government, what Russell Schreiber has done to save water in this city, the direct potable reuse program has done for this city, we should all be enjoying that. We should all be celebrating that. We should all be hand in hand saying, this is what we're doing. Our car washes are doing it. Other businesses are doing it. Individuals are doing it. We fully accept when a customer says, I'm not going to wash my car as much. But it's hard to take, and it's acceptance. It's not compliance. It's acceptance when the city says, but we're going to take, and we're going to take, and we're going to take. You know, and we don't know. We don't know. If we get down that number, or we get down that road, and we find that we're losing money, we'll go the same route that businesses, for many different reasons, have chosen. And we may have to close, or at least that part of our business. We don't know what that future holds, and we're scared of it.
Anybody else? Thank you, Jim. Andy, name and address, please.
Andy Coker, 3 Olive Branch Court in Wichita Falls. I've been a customer of All American Car Wash since they opened in 1997. All American Car Wash has spent hundreds of thousands of dollars to do, to do their part in conserving water. Vehicles are usually the second biggest investment that an individual can own. People, including myself, like to protect that investment by keeping it clean to protect the paint and the value of that vehicle. I personally do not think that it's fair to isolate one type of business and threaten them with cutting off their water supply. As members of city government, it should be your job to help them, not to hurt them. I'm asking each one of you to put yourselves in their shoes. If this were your business and your employees that you are trying to protect, would you not expect the same? The amount of water that they use to wash one car is very minimal, and what they don't reuse themselves goes back into the reuse system that has been installed. The citizens of Wichita Falls have gone above and beyond your expectations to save and conserve water, and they will continue to do the same. Personally, I have gone from washing my personal vehicles from once per week to about once a month, except in the cases of tree sap or the infamous attack from the birds. As a small business owner myself, I know how devastating these actions would have on my business as well. With that being said, I'm asking all of you to please lift the restrictions from the car washes and let them know that you're in support of all businesses in Wichita Falls. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Andy. Name and address, please, ma'am. It'll pull down. There you go.
Vanda Keller, 4107 York, Wichita Falls, Texas.
Go ahead.
I think that we all agree that our community is to be commended for our response to the need to conserve water. While some changes that each of us have made to conserve were rather simple and obvious, other ways to conserve water were suggested to us through educational efforts that heightened our awareness both of the seriousness of the issue at hand and of less obvious ways to lower our personal water consumption. Seemingly, public awareness and education were and can continue to be key elements in appropriately dealing with the needs of our community. It is my understanding, and it has been voiced here this morning, that some are concerned about the public perception of some, and that some are making decisions and even policy based on perception versus fact. I understand this concern, as I often have said, that for some people, perception is reality. But my plea this morning is that if the perception is flawed or inaccurate, then let's change the perception to become that of fact-based. With the public education campaign, inaccurate perception can be changed. I believe that the public is entitled to know and to understand the facts regarding the actual consumption of water by the car wash industry. One fact that has been stated several times this morning is that with the water reclamation that is in place now, that if all the car washes in Wichita Falls were to close, only 8 hours, one third of one day out of 365 days, only 8 hours of water consumption will be saved. My question is that in the big picture, in the four-year picture, does a difference of a couple days really justify all of the negative impact that can take place currently if these businesses have to close in our community? I also question if we really want the national attention shining on our city. I believe that being the first municipality to refrain from allowing businesses to the public water supply will no doubt make national news. I also expect that national media will be educated, knowing that only or less than a quarter of a percent of our daily usage is consumed by car washes. And again, the amount being saved does not justify the devastation. This negative attention certainly will not define Wichita Falls as a business-friendly community. It will not help to attract commerce and industry, and certainly will not make it a desired community to raise a family. I have not touched on the negative economic impact as our area continues to strive to pull out of a sluggish economy, closing a dozen businesses and having approximately 100 people become unemployed does not seem logical to me. Closure of our car washes would have an immediate negative economic impact to the tune of approximately $4.8 million annually, not to mention other monetary leakage that will inevitably follow. The 20% restriction is penalizing the industry that has been one of our leaders regarding water conservation. With the amazing response from the public, including our self-imposed restrictions that have led to huge water savings, with reusing 100% of our affluent water, with efforts that are in place for further conservation, such as those of Alcoa and PPG, and with fact-based public education, I respectfully suggest to you that Wichita Falls will fare much better from these positive efforts to deal with this, to use facts versus inaccurate perception in making these decisions. Small business is the backbone of our local economy, of the state and nation as well. Instead of closing businesses, if our combined level falls below 20%, consider asking each of us to make additional contributions. My understanding is that if each household flushed their toilets one less time a day, we would have more water than if we closed all of the car washes. Also, as has been pointed out earlier today, please be conscious of the fact that it's not only the car wash owners and their families that will suffer financially. The ripple effect is far-reaching. Asking car washes to rely solely on non-potable water is not a reasonable solution either. It would increase overhead by as much as $2,000 a day. I can't see that it's reasonable that another approximately 200 cars a day would have to be washed to break even, when really the mentality is that we're trying to conserve water. I would ask that let's continue to make reasonable and effective adaptations that benefit all of our community, including all of our businesses. I ask that you relax the restriction on our car washes. There are other solutions that can be reached. Thank you.
Thank you, Vanda.
Name and address, please. My name is Chuck Bradley, number 3 Villa Court. I have the quick and easy car wash on the corner of Avenue and Kemp. I had no intention of coming up here today and talking. I was just going to listen. But I came up mainly just to clarify a few things from Ms. Dodson. You had asked about people who would be closing. I was trying my best to stay open. I've checked into it. Financially, I don't think it would benefit me to do it and try to make a living at it. It won't. But with my bank mortgage, my taxes, my insurance, the lights will have to be on all night, whether it's open or not. Someone will have to be up there watching it because of vandalism. To close would run me about $3,000 to $3,500 a month. That's being conservative. That's what it would cost me to close without any income. So the other side of that is, I was thinking about closing, but I think, well, the alternative water source is going to be a fortune also. But I could work 7 days a week and break even and still be able to let one man have a job besides myself and keep vandalism and also keep my equipment running. If it sits for 6 months, a year, there's going to be more repairs than you can handle. The other thing you had mentioned was the meeting when we met with the Water Resource Commission. When we were there, it was fighting for, they were going to close us 3 days a week and 20 and shut us at 20%. Mr. Oliver was heading that meeting, and before we left that meeting, his words to us were, okay, so can everybody agree to the just closing you 2 days a week and 20%? Well, we said, and Mr. Schreiber was there, if I say anything that's not right, he's welcome to step in. But we said we would rather close the 2 days, although of course we'd rather have one at that time that we were doing, but if you're giving us an option. But we still said that closing at 20% was not right. Mr. Oliver at that time said, okay, so we'll say that you're still going to close at the 2 days, but at that time he said, but it will be closed at 20%. That was words. Okay, so what do you do? You say, okay, we've saved the day, we'll fight a battle later. What can you do? I would like to say one other thing, that at that meeting Mr. Oliver was heading, he had mentioned that his water bill for 1 month, I think he was speaking of a year ago July, but his words at the meeting were, I used 30 units 1 month and I'm cutting back. I ran my water bill for the last 6 months of last year, I averaged 29. Last month I ran 27, the month before 29. He has cut back, but he was heading the meeting and he was not even aware of my water use. I mean, I know he's a great gentleman. I'm just saying that wasn't informed when the meeting started. The other thing was, it's kind of hard to remember to get up here. Mention one other thing. Well, I'll let it go with that. I just want to let you know that if I close, I'm broke. If I stay even, I work 7 days a week to break even to keep my car wash from going under.
Question.
Okay. Yes, sir.
When you said 28, do you mean at your house or at your car wash?
At my car wash. I have a 6-bay self-service on Kemp Street. There are others that use less than me. I've talked to 2 other car wash owners that said, I'm not going to fight it. I can't win. I'm not going to work 7 days a week to break even. I also talked to one of the gentlemen that has a car wash out by the base that is operating on well water right now. He called me. He said, I can't do this. I'm not even breaking even on this deal. So we'll see how long that lasts also for the people who are trying it. It's not going to work. Down the road, it's not going to work. Thank you so much.
I have a question for you. So my understanding, if we lift the 20% usage for the car wash, are you saying you want us to lift the 2 days a week also?
No, ma'am. We can live with that. We can live with that. My car wash was down 65% for November.
Okay.
That's how much I was down. So, and not to mention, I'm not for sure about the daily use of car washes. When that figure was taken? Was it taken for so far this year? Because daily use has gone down so much. Pardon me 1 minute. I mean, our car washes, like, sure, we did, I've consumed a lot. We did use a lot more water, but we were doing it to keep our business up. My parking lot used to be washed down every day. We watched people would use Armor All and all kinds of stuff on their cars. We'd wash our parking lot. We'd have to keep our vacuums washed down with a washdown hose. Appearance is what brings customers in any business. Appearance. So you tried to keep that up. My parking lot has not been washed down now in a year and a half, I don't know. We get out there. I keep my buckets that I get my chemicals in, and I set them out. I have an enclosed area. Anytime we get any moisture and water goes in that bucket, my helper will help me. We take those buckets out and we'll pour it on the spot just a little bit, hit it with a broom, brush it. You have to do what you can to keep it clean. So what I'm saying is everybody that was washing down has quit. Of course, that was an ordinance anyway. So I would question that we're still using as much water as people might think. I just don't believe it would, especially when you talk about, when you ask about how many units was it for my home or for that. My home, I'm 1 to 2. But and I had put in a water well at my house for my grass. But it's not going to be feasible to haul water except to break even. Nobody's going to make money. And who, you know, you're working 7 days. I'm 65 years old. I hate working 7 days a week to break even. Thank you so much. I appreciate everybody's time.
Anybody else? Okay, we're going to recess into executive code or executive session in accordance with local government code 551.071. We'll be back in about 20 or 30 minutes, I hope. Back to order. We're returning from executive session where no votes or polls were taken. And just so you'll know, this executive session was taken under item 11B on the agenda, if you have a copy of the agenda there that was available out front before the meeting. Is there anybody else that has any comments or questions that they want to ask of this body or present to this body on the topic of the item that's under consideration at this point in time? I would. Michael?
Chris?
Bobby?
Can I say something right quick?
Yeah, come sure. On up. Name and address for the record, Bobby.
I'm Bobby Schaff, number 4 champions here in Wichita. Mad at myself because I didn't get up a while ago, so thanks for the opportunity to say something. My job every day is to sell this city. That's what I do. And perception means a lot. We've gained so much ground with the perception of our reuse water plan. If you're lucky enough to be able to go through the Cypress out here, you are just overwhelmed with the progress that we've made. It seems counterproductive to me, and I don't know the numbers on what we're going to save or yield or get to the good part by cutting the car washes. I don't know that number. I apologize for that. I'm talking about perception. I take the Star Telegram, and I can't tell you how much it bugs me every time I go out and on the front page there'll be a color picture of Lake Wichita or Lake Arrowhead on the Star Telegram, and there'll be a great big nasty article, negative article about our city and what we're doing. Now that's changed a little bit lately since we've got the reuse program going. There's not so much of it, and we're admired, and it just is regretful. The question I would say is it's a regretful thing, and I don't know what you guys have decided back there, but it's a regretful thing to me with the perception that I think we have a positive perception from the market right now. I do, because of this reuse program, and I hate to see us change that perception by going the other direction and starting to shut down small businesses. And I just want to make sure that the bang that we get for our buck by closing those facilities is worth the negative perception that we may possibly get.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bobby. Michael?
Bobby, I take the Star Telegram too. I'm with you on that. You know, this has been a very difficult, long process, and we're still going through it, and it's because of the drought. It's not anyone's fault in this room. It's not any citizen's fault. It's the drought. But the things this council has done to mitigate the effects of the drought and look to the future, not just short term, although we do that, but long term, 10 years, 15 years, 50 years. Some of the things that we've had to do, and I have to say this to remind everyone, we are in this together. We have affected many different groups, industries, and individuals. Oil and gas, we've restricted them from using lake water. That was 2012. They had to find alternative sources to do their work in the oil field. Landscaping, we restricted them to once a week at their places of business in 2012. We lowered that some 12 hours, still once a week in 2013. Finally, we had to restrict all potable water use for individuals as well as business as far as landscaping. That was also in 2013. Many of us have found alternative sources of water. The construction industry, we've had to restrict them from using potable water, 2013. We also pulled all fire hydrant meters for use by the construction industry. They had to find an alternative source of water. Pools, both individuals and others, we restricted them from draining and filling in 2012. And eventually in 2013 restricted them from using potable water. They also had to find alternative sources for their pools. Agriculture, the Wichita County Water District restricted using lake water in 2012 for many, many agricultural landowners throughout our area. That was in 2012. They've had to find alternative sources of water, which has been very, very difficult. Castaway Cove, this council restricted them, a city entity, from using potable water, and they had to find an alternative source of water this last summer. Our golf courses, they have been restricted from using lake water. They've had to find alternative sources. Luckily, through many of these, the rain that has come in the past 2 years has kept us going, has put water back in the lake, has given our city lawns, individuals I'm talking about, shrubbery and other landscaping, has kept much of that alive, thank God. Large industries, the city has required them to complete a water audit. That was in 2013. There has been progress from that. We have two large industries that have come up with plans, working with city staff, to use non-potable water in their processes. There again, these water savings that were identified in their individual audits hopefully will be in place in a timely fashion. Electricity, this is way in the future, we hope. Wichita Falls and the Wichita County Water District has restricted the electrical plant between here and Vernon are in their contract. It will be restricted once Lake Kemp is at 50,000 acre feet. And as many of you know, and some do not know, at that point, that's where the remaining 50,000 acre feet becomes the property of the city of Wichita Falls. That's our ace in the hole if our other two lakes do go dry. That electrical plant will have to find an alternative source or shut down their 700 megawatt power plant. So although I'm empathetic to the plight of the car washing industry, and believe me, I'll miss it if it happens. I like to keep my cars at least as clean as I can, but they're not the only ones. I would say they are the ones that will be most effective because it will possibly mean letting employees go. I hate that. But folks, these decisions have to be made. These decisions are important to our future. These decisions are ones that these groups and others that I haven't listed have been affected by. What happens if we accept this today and allow the car washing industry to keep pumping water until the lakes go dry? Who's going to take the calls I'll get at that point and say, well, we're out of water. Why did you let the car wash guys continue to use water? I can see both sides. It's terrible to be the devil's advocate within yourself, but that's what we have to do. That's what this council has been doing for almost 4 years. It's a terrible problem, but it's on our desk. It's something we have to deal with. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve an ordinance amending section 106-186 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Wichita Falls to establish modified water conservation drought contingency rules and providing for codification. We'll do a show of hands. All in favor, say aye, or show aye. Right hand. Three, four. Okay. All opposed? Motion passes.
Item 8B is an ordinance authorizing the issuance and sale of combination tax and revenue certificates of obligation series 2015, levying an annual ad valorem tax and providing for the security for and payment of such certificates, declaring an emergency, declaring an effective date, and authorizing and enacting other matters, provisions relating to this subject.
Is there a motion?
Second.
Jim?
Good morning, Mayor, members of the council. This is the ordinance that would adopt a 30-year bond issuance for our indirect potable reuse project that's estimated to be about $33.8 million in construction and engineering costs. The ordinance is drafted such that $33.545 million would actually be issued because the Texas Water Development Board has granted us a forgiveness of about $252,000 for a project, for this project being green and environmentally sound and so forth. So we would be adopting this ordinance today and actually borrowing $33.545 million to finance that project. I won't go into what the project involves, but we anticipate that it's about a 3-year construction time frame to complete the project. We would receive the proceeds of the bonds in January and begin spending those down over the next 3 years. I'll mention that this issue was done slightly differently than what we've done in the past. We have applied for and received the loan program or the loan approval through the Texas Water Development Board's Clean Water Act loan program. And what that does for the city is write down the interest that we receive on this 30-year bond issuance by 1.2%. I've calculated that $33 million over 30 years at a 1.2% lower interest rate to be approximately $8 million in savings over that 30-year period of time. So it's a very favorable interest rate. And Murphy Davis, our financial advisor, is here today along with Leroy Grollinger of McCall, Parkhurst, and Horton, who is our bond counsel, to answer any questions that you might have. Murphy's going to go over the exact details of the financing, and he has a handout in just a minute. Now, last thing that I would say is that you've already increased your retail water rates in August to provide the financing necessary to pay this debt service, so there's no need to adjust water rates any further for this project. And even though the full faith and credit of the city's taxing authority is used as a pledge for this security, we don't intend to utilize any property taxes to pay off the debt. It would be the water rates and the water revenues from the system that we would be using to pay off the debt. So with that, I'm going to ask Murphy to come up and go over the details of the financing and the interest rates and so forth and so on. And Leroy's here as well if you have any legal questions from him. Murphy?
Thanks, Jim. I'll just do it later. I'll just do the handout later. Jim's covered some of the basic points, and just for clarification for the mayor's question of residents, I'm at 22 Chateau, and I represent Century Management Incorporated, and we have been very pleased and thankful to be to have represented this city and other city councils for many years, and for that we're very appreciative. There's one thing that Jim was just talking about on the financing, and the financing is to get a more permanent solution to what the city has done on a temporary basis up until this point. And so it's a, I'd say that there might be 1 or 2% of the people in the community that doesn't want to do this project. This is a very, very positive for the city of Wichita Falls. And one thing that I don't hear from the city and the administrators and all that I think should be brought forward on a public forum, so I'm exercising that right to speak about this financing. For Darren, Jim, all of the people that are involved in this have put hours, many hours, the staff has had many hours of work on getting this financing done. And as Jim just mentioned, it's anywhere from about $7 to $8 million savings to the city for this financing. So I think we all agree this financing needs to be done for our water for a more permanent solution to what we're having on a temporary basis up until this point. And with that, the net interest cost is 1.82. The true interest cost is 1.80. That is set by the Texas Water Development Board. They give us that rate. It's based on a national rate for the ratings that the city has. I bring this up just quickly, that your high rating of AA meant that it cost you that much less, because if you're A rated, it would have cost probably another $1 million in the additional interest rate, because in it, the MMD for the A rating would be that much of an impact to you on the financing cost. So that you are good stewards of the financial stability of this city helps not only the current people, but it helps all the people that are going to be here in the future. So I commend you for that, because you don't get next to the highest rating that you can possibly get, which is AAA, if you're not good stewards from the economic perspective. So with that, I will answer any questions that you might have. And we'll be meeting if you decide to pass this particular ordinance that we'll meet later after the council adjourns so that we can get some signatures on the paperwork. But other than that, I'd be happy to take any questions that anyone might have.
Okay. What is your estimate on the interest rate?
It's set. 1.80 is the true interest cost. 1.82 is the net interest cost. True interest cost has some present value calculations in that. So anywhere from 1.82 to 1.80 is what we're doing this for 30 years. In fact, based upon that scale, the first 3 to 4 years, you're paying no interest on those maturities, because as we dropped that 1.2% down, it wasn't at 1.2%, so it took it down to zero.
Who would be potential buyers for
it's the Texas Water Development Board. They're doing it. They're subsidized by the people of the state of Texas. And this is the project your project was qualified. And Russell, I think, probably has done the most work on this. Russell, I didn't mean to leave you out when I was saying the people that are involved here. But this is the financing is done through the Texas Water Development Board. The Texas Water Development Board does their financing. They are in essence subsidizing this community for the project that you are doing and clean water project, and that's what their goal is. That's one of their goals of the Texas Water Development Board.
Thank you. Any other questions from council?
And so my understanding is, if this is passed today, the we won't have a rate increase for our water or taxes or anything on the citizens.
For this project.
For this project. Thank you.
Now, that does not include any future projects that will be bonded and financed under separate packages. So.
But this one is really, this is good news, and I still can't tell you how many hours have been put in by your staff here in getting it accomplished, because it did. It's anywhere from that $7-8 million savings to the taxpayers of and users of the facilities itself.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve an ordinance authorizing the issuance and sale of combination tax and revenue certificates of obligation 2015 series. Levies an annual ad valorem tax and provides for the security for payment of such certificates, declaring an emergency, declaring an effective date, and authorizing and enacting other matters and provisions related to the subject. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Item 8C is an ordinance transferring $319,864 from the Water Sewer Fund to the Debt Service Interest and Sinking Fund for the first annual debt service payment of the Combination Tax and Revenue Certificates of Obligation Series 2015 to comply with the guidelines of the Texas Water Development Board.
Is there a motion?
Second.
Jim?
Thank you, Mayor. This is a related item to the financing. One of the requirements of the Texas Water Development Board's loan program is to show on our accounting records that we're actually depositing the annual principal and interest payments that are required to pay off this debt into a separate interest and sinking fund. Typically, we pay our water revenue debt service from our water fund. And all of this is simply transferring the money that's already been budgeted in your water fund to the interest and sinking fund to meet their requirements. The first annual payment is interest only of $319,864 for the 2015 fiscal year. In the future, we'll set this up in when you adopt the budget to reflect the accounting that's required in the Texas Water Development Board, but we didn't do that this time with the budget.
Okay. Any questions or comments from council? Questions or comments from the public? Have a motion and a second to accept an ordinance transferring $319,864 from the Water Sewer Fund to the Debt Service Interest and Sinking Fund for the first annual debt service payment of the Combination Tax and Revenue COs. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Item 9A is a resolution approving the execution and delivery of a loan agreement with loan forgiveness with the Texas Water Development Board and resolving other matters relating to this subject.
Is there a motion?
So moved. Second.
Jim?
Again, this is the last item related to the financing for the IPR water project. And as I mentioned earlier, the Texas Water Development Board approved the City of Wichita Falls project as a project that, quote, is green infrastructure, a water efficient improvement, and an environmentally innovative activity. Because the project meets those requirements, the Texas Water Development Board is able to actually give us a grant in the amount of $252,597, which reduces the amount of funding that we needed to finance over the 30-year debt. So this is receiving that award or that loan from the Texas Water Development. It's actually a grant, but it's called loan forgiveness. So they're forgiving us on the actual amount that they're loaning us.
Okay. Any questions from council? From the public? Being none, we have a motion and a second to accept a resolution approving the execution and delivery of a loan agreement with loan forgiveness with the TWDB and resolving other matters relating to the subject. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Item 9B is a resolution confirming appointment to the Firefighters and Police Officers Civil Service Commission.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Darren?
Mayor and council members, as you may know, the Civil Service Commission is made up of a three-member group that provides direction, reviews certain civil service actions that come before the group as it relates to the state's chapter governing civil service, which is 143. Certain instances, there may be disputes that would come up involving tests or other matters regarding Chapter 143 that the Civil Service Commission has to act upon. Under state law, the city manager is charged with selecting individuals to serve on this commission, and the council role is to confirm or deny the selection. So it's a little bit different than your other boards and commissions. Essentially, I present a name to you, and you have a thumbs up or thumbs down as part of the process. For this particular one, Ms. Penny Miller is currently serving on the commission, and her term expires at the end of this year. She desires to continue serving on the commission. I believe she can serve one more term before she's term limited out, and it would be my recommendation that you vote to give her one more term to serve on Civil Service Board. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any discussion? Okay, I have a motion and a second to accept a resolution confirming appointment to the Firefighters and Police Officers Civil Service Commission, reappointing Penny Miller to that board for another term. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Item 9C is a resolution authorizing the purchase of various size Toro mowers through the Buy Board Cooperative Purchasing Program from Professional Turf Products LP in the amount of $128,904.99.
Is there a motion? Peggy?
Good morning, Mayor, Council. The resolution before you is to authorize us to go ahead and do the purchase of our annual replacement of mowers for our Parks Maintenance Division. Every year we purchased about 2 to 3 72-inch mowers, 2 to 3 60-inch mowers, and then one larger unit, which could be a 9-foot, 11-foot, or a 16-foot. This year we are purchasing the 16-foot mower. As you can see, they came in slightly over what we had it originally budgeted for them. However, in the following item, where we actually bid the 60-inch mowers, allowing our local provider an opportunity to bid, the budgeted cost for those was $60,000, and they're coming in well under that. So totally, between the two items, all of the mowers are under budget. The reason we did not bid the two mowers that you see purchasing from the Cooperative Purchasing Program is because the way they have their dealership set up, our local provider cannot provide us with that larger unit. The only place in our market that we're able to purchase them is through the Texas Cooperative Purchasing Buy Board Program.
Okay. Any discussion? Any questions for Peggy? Comments from the public? Yes. Okay, we have a motion and a second to accept a resolution authorizing the purchase of various size Toro mowers through the Buy Board Cooperative Purchasing Program from Professional Turf Products in the amount of $128,904.99. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Item 9D is a resolution awarding the bid for the purchase of 4 60-inch Toro mowers from the low bidder Longhorn Incorporated in the amount of $48,292, or to the local bidder Baron Turf and Tractor in the amount of $50,260.
Is there a motion?
Second.
Okay, Peggy? I will tell you that you don't normally see us bid this product because it normally comes under the $50,000 range. However, this year we are purchasing two mowers for the Parks Maintenance Division, and two of these mowers will be going to our wastewater treatment plant. The local bidder, Baron Turf and Tractor, came in at $50,260, and Longhorn was at $48,292. That's a difference of 4.1%, which does put Baron Turf and Tractor within that 5% range that allows you the opportunity to award the bid to the local bidder rather than the low bidder. And I think...
Yeah, they're sitting over there.
Yeah. There's someone here from Baron Turf and Tractor that would like to give you a little bit of information on their company, which will allow you to make the decision that you need to make.
Good morning. My name is Jay Barron. I'm co-owner of Barron Turf and Tractor with my brother Lee Barron. We've been in business since 2005. We are a spinoff of Barron Brothers, a third generation spinoff, which has been in business for over 70 years in the local area. We are the local servicing dealer for these particular Toro mowers that the city will be purchasing, and they have purchased them from us in the past. We will be providing parts and service for any warranty repairs on these mowers. We are just here today. We want to show our appreciation for your past support and ask you for support for today and in the future. We know you have a responsibility to the taxpayers to spend their money wisely, but once again, we, as a local and small business, we feel like the money spent locally is money spent wisely. We know our bid's not the lowest, but we do feel like it provides the best benefit to the city and the citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, Jay.
Question?
Yes.
Jay? Yahoo. Sorry. How many employees do you have?
We currently have 12 full-time and 2 part-time.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Any questions from the public? Okay, someone's going to have to make an amendment to the motion if they want to go with the local provider.
I'd like to amend the ordinance to go with Barron Turf and Tractor.
Okay. Is there a second?
So moved.
Okay. Have a motion and a second to amend the ordinance as presented to award the bid to Barron Turf and Tractor. Any discussion? Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Now we have a motion and a second to authorize award of bid for the purchase of 4 60-inch Toro mowers from Barron Turf and Tractor in the amount of $50,260. Any discussion? Any comments from the public? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Item 9E is a resolution authorizing the purchase of 9 in-car video systems and 6 Cycle Vision motorcycle video systems from L3 Communications Mobile Vision Incorporated in the amount of $70,800.
Is there a motion? Chief?
Morning, Mayor, Council. Every year we budget in our capital improvement plan video systems for our police fleet. Typically we have been budgeting 15. This year we got 9 vehicles instead of the regular 15, so we'll be putting camera systems in those vehicles. However, we're going to have 6 left, and we're wanting to put those on our motorcycles. This will be the first year that we use those on our motorcycles. Typically, our motorcycle officers, which is a requirement under the bias profiling program, that they have to have either a camera system or a digital recorder. Typically, they use digital recorders, our motorcycle officers do. With the way the landscape in our society is changing and the ability for the technology that's out there, we're wanting to put these camera systems now on our motorcycles so that we can get a better picture of what's happening with the interactions with our traffic officers and our public. Typically, it's just a video an audio recording is all we get. This will give us an opportunity for us to get video like we do with our cars.
Okay. Any questions or comments from
question?
Tim?
Chief, will it be on their person? Yeah, they'll have it on their person, so when they get up, they'll be able to...
No, this will be a camera system that'll be attached to the motorcycle. Okay. Now, they are going to have a wireless microphone that when they go up to the car, it records.
I know they talked, it's been in the news about, you know, having a personal video device, you know, so that when someone gets out of the car and he's going over here, she gets moved.
We had looked at that possibility. Some of the issues that you have with the body cams as opposed to a video recorder that's off the vehicle is that you're getting a constant look. With the body cam, it's just whatever direction that, that officer may be turning at the time and whatever the situation may be. So we felt at the time we'd get a better look at what's occurring. We also wanted to go with the L3 system because our whole infrastructure is set up with L3 at this time, our servers, our disk recorders and all that. So if we get these L3 ones for our motorcycles, we can integrate it right into the current infrastructure that we have with our L3 system.
Now, that's not to negate the possibility that sometime in the future the department will look at body cams. I think with any federal monies that might become available down the road, of course, they'll certainly look at that.
Yeah,
and I
mean,
think they're testing too right now. In the
field. That's always a possibility. But I think at the time we did look at those and we determined that this was really what we're trying to capture.
Okay. Any other questions from council? Questions or comments from the public? Being none, we have a motion and a second to accept a resolution authorizing the purchase of 9 in-car video systems and 6 CycleVision motorcycle video systems from L3 Communication Mobile Vision in the amount of $70,800. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Thank
We're
going
to break at this point to sign some paperwork, as well as we will take care of an executive session in accordance with Local Government Code 551.074. And there will be a staff report on the airport update.
Yeah, Mayor and Council, thank you. John Burris is going to give us a brief update on the airport, the new airport construction project.
And I did have a 30-minute PowerPoint presentation too, but I can tell y'all are not in the mood.
Go for it. I can start calling you Jim.
We'll be quick about this. The city manager wanted me to give you an update where we're at today and what the next few months look like out at the Wichita Falls Regional Airport. This Saturday, December 6th, we're going to have a public open house. We'd love for everybody to stop by the airport. We'll be open from 10 to 2. We actually take ownership of the building on the 8th, so this would be a good time for the public to get out and see some of the areas that would normally be secured once the building is open. On December 8th, we actually get the keys to the facility. That's a key date for the Museum of North Texas History because they'll be moving in their other display items, finishing up getting those displays set up. The mural will probably go on for another 2 months. If you've not seen the work done on that mural, it is absolutely outstanding, particularly the attention to detail that is going into that process. Right now, we're scheduled to open December 17th, so once the last flight comes in on the 16th, we'll start moving all the TSA equipment, American Eagle, and rental car items over into the new facility. Should be ready to take the first flight on the 17th out of the new facility. People keep asking what we're going to do with the old terminal building. We've already got plans in place to do some minor abatement, remediation, particularly with asbestos. It's not a lot in the building. Most of that was taken care of when we turned the restaurant into the TSA break room and offices and such. We anticipate the old terminal building coming down sometime in mid-January. I'm thinking about using it as a fundraiser to sell 3 swings with a sledgehammer for $1, but I don't think we've got time with the number of people wanting to swing at it, so we'll get through with that quick. I think they're going to get it down in about a week. They're going to move quick. In the footprint of the old terminal building, we're going to put in additional parking. We're looking at going with covered parking. We'll sell, that'll be a premium product we provide for our customers out there. So once that old building comes down, they're going to start work on that parking lot pretty quick. I'm also happy to say that we do have a food and beverage concessionaire that we received an RFP from last week. I actually met with them out at the new terminal building on Saturday for a few hours. There's some minor changes we're going to have to make to what we thought would be the kitchen area to accommodate their needs. I've seen the menu, and I'll get that menu to the city manager to share with you, but I'm very excited about this new addition and new service we're going to be providing to our customers out there. we'll probably be working on getting that contract finished up, and hopefully we can get that to council at the next meeting as well. One issue that has come up, and it's not a major issue, but it's something that we'll be bringing back to you as a city council, is the parking, the long-term parking. With the addition of the museum wing and with the addition of a food and beverage concessionaire, we didn't see how we could realistically charge somebody $10 to park and then turn around and efficiently reimburse them for their money. In fact, we figured that, thought that would be a distraction to people wanting to come to the museum or come to the airport for lunch. So right now our proposal to the council will be to go with $2 a day parking, but with the first hour and a half to 2 hours free, so that if people wanted to come visit the museum, they would just get their ticket at the entrance gate. They could hang out at the museum, they could grab lunch, and when they exit, insert that ticket, and it would let them out free. There'll be an upgrade in equipment to make that accommodation, but we think that's probably going to be our best solution, given the fact that we have these two tenants in the new facility.
So that'll be a pay-as-you-leave situation?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Correct. Now, the argument, there was some debate about allowing them to use short-term metered parking, but then again, that also poses problem because it reduces the ability for somebody to pull up there and pick up passengers. Plus, we want to enforce that short-term parking more aggressively to keep cars moving in and out. We've actually, in the old terminal, have had people park there in lieu of paying the $3 in the lot to stay there for 3 or 4 days. So we've got to be a little bit more aggressive with that. I also think that solves our long-term problem of having people drop vehicles off there for months at a time. And in fact, we had a wrecked car in there for a while. But if it's a $2 a day fee, then that's going to add up pretty quick. Still very cost effective in our opinion, but we can get into those discussions when I bring that to council for change. Finally, one project that we desperately need to get resolved, and it'll probably be something we tackle this spring, is the entrance road. I know there have been some discussions with the city manager in regards to what he wants done there. Currently, we're pricing it. We're going to have two prices, one for concrete, curb and gutter, second price for asphalt. We'll see what our financial situation is like once we get the major portions of the project finished and what direction we want to go there. But that's about it on the update, other than we've got about 2 weeks, about 2 weeks to get this thing open and ready to get it done and start working out of that new building.
Okay. Thank you, John.
Mayor, that's the end of staff reports. It would take us to items of concern and members of the council at this time.
Okay. We'll start with Ben.
Don't have anything further today.
Okay.
Nothing else.
Tim? If you got any items of concern, you better get over here because we're past you and everybody else is bowed out. You're up.
You know, I continue to get concerns voiced by citizens about our signal lights throughout the city. I mean, there's certain areas, and we all know them, like if you're trying to cross Kemp, you might wait, it seems like forever. I wonder if we could not research available grants, funding outside our regular budget to take a really, really close look at a way to better our signal system. You know, back in the 60s, Wichita Falls entered a, I don't remember the details, but entered a cooperative grant, IBM somebody, and we were really on the cutting edge of technology at that time with signal synchronization, etc. I'd sure like to see us make an effort to do that, and I guess that's in John's shop. I've noticed several intersections crossing Kell West, Kell East and West, traffic, I mean, maybe it's just a matter of, you know, traffic is really increasing, but particularly McNeil at Kell, of course, Lawrence at Kell is, I think we know what that is, but there are some areas where all of a sudden it seems like you really have to wait minutes. And I know they've tried to work through that, that McNeil at Kell is affected by Caulfield at McNeil, da-da-da-da. But surely to gosh, in this 21st century, there's something out there that would assist us in being a little bit more effective and efficient with our signal system.
Michael, John can step in and answer the question too, but you're right. I mean, some of it I think is traffic patterns changing.
Yeah.
And we're reacting to that. But I also think a large part of it is simply just the systems we have in place. Yeah. They can fail over time.
Yeah.
And a lot of times we don't know about it until somebody complains. They probably get tired of hearing from me and getting emails because, you know, if I see a controller not work the way I think it should work, you know, I'm emailing them. And we may have a circuit board go out or a camera system go out. So that's a large part of it, too. I think we're using the latest technology, but what we may need to do better, and maybe it's a staffing issue, is proactively go around and check all these intersections to make sure they're all working as they were set up, synchronized to set up work. Right now, I think we react to the ones we see or the ones we get complaints about. But, you know, we'll look at it, and there may be some other latest technology out there to help synchronize that. But so I think it's a combination of those two factors that we need to do, take a look at and do a better job with.
Yeah. Thank you. Saw a recent bit of information, and I always like to report, if I think it hasn't gone out otherwise, through this venue, that Kickapoo Airport has an annual economic impact on our city of almost $5 million. That is great. And I know John and his people have worked over the last however many years the city's owned that, 10 plus, to really make that a great place to fly in and out of. And, you know, there's aviation buffs everywhere. People just like to go out and watch planes. But, you know, when it's a positive economic impact and the city owns it, that's almost unusual, and I think that's really good news for the citizens and our organization. Recently I saw a blurb come out on our trustee lots and having to mow them every growing season, and I don't know, we've been down this road before, and I think talked about it as strategic planning, and of course, Jack is, it lands on his desk as far as the mowing responsibilities, but I'd like to see us put that on the strategic planning agenda, and y'all tell us what's going on and what maybe you see as some solutions. I know Pat's trying to sell every lot that she can and has some success at that, but we have some hundreds of these trustee lots that we're responsible for, and it's a big job. It's just a huge job. So maybe there's a new and better way to approach that. Water conservation. You know, we're water. But recently, and I, being on the Water Resources Commission, this has been discussed, and I'd like to see it come back. And maybe the Water Resources Commission needs to meet again sometime on various things that are going on with water. But we talked at length about having projects with the apartments in particular, the prison, which I know is a state entity, but maybe if we had some pull with our representative and our senator from this area, maybe we could get some assistance there. I think there is a lot of room for conservation efforts and results through these apartments and the prison. I don't know what we could do. There's incentive programs where, you know, the city will give new apparatus, you know, new water-saving devices. I don't know. I see these things all the time about cities that are in similar shape that we are, and they're trying to conserve water. I think we need to look at that. You know, that's the number one issue, conserve what we've got. So I think we need to make an attempt, and that's my understanding about what the Water Resources Commission is supposed to do. So maybe it's time to call them back. I know we haven't met in a while, and take a look. Code enforcement, my hat's off to them. They, after probably a couple of years now, have come to the end of a process whereby we hired some extra staff, we got some additional 21st century devices to input data about housing, buildings throughout the city. And we now have what's called a neighborhood assessment map. And Kevin has headed this up, and I know it's been a long process. We had to hire people. We had to train everybody. We had to get the devices. We had to learn how to do all that. But we now have a neighborhood assessment map that shows throughout the city the condition of housing and other buildings throughout the city. And it's an assessment that I think is going to allow code enforcement to be proactive, more proactive than it has been, because they've got the information. I mean, on this map, you can see where, hey, there's maybe a problem in this part of town. Maybe the condition of the houses is going down a little bit. That affects property values. You know, you would think people in that part of town would say, hey, you know, I don't want my property values to go down. Let's go and have a neighborhood group, and let's see if we can't improve the condition of our part of town and hold our property values, our big investment. But just the fact that we've gotten through this process to this point is really good, and I think that too, I'd like to see Kevin bring to the strategic planning meeting in early February, you know, where we're at, what we're doing. We can take a look at the maps. I think everyone's gotten a copy of it by now. But it's a great body of knowledge that we can use to improve our city.
That it?
That's it. Thank you.
Okay, I have nothing. That moves us to item 12, appointments to the following boards and commissions. Airport Board of Adjustment.
Yes, Mayor, in position one, I'd like to appoint Samuel Emmering. Position two, reappoint Chad Hughes. Position three, reappoint Amy Brobowitz. All three for expire on 12/31/16.
Okay, have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to appoint members as stated by Councilor Engel to the Airport Board of Adjustments, terms to expire 12/31/2016. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Animal Shelter Advisory Committee.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to nominate the following. We have three expirations, and Dr. Brian Wade is currently serving and would like to be reappointed. Also, Katrina Mitchell, who is our chair and is currently serving, would be reappointed. And Jan Herzog, currently serving, would be reappointed and is serving. We do need, maybe this is not time to discuss this one, but Stephen Dodge, our rabies control officer and basically our supervisor of our animal control folks, has recently retired, and that one is open, but it has to be rabies control certified.
Right, that position was vacated when
Steve Dodge retired on November 30th. That position has to be filled by the current Rabies Control Authority. Y'all appointed Katrina Mitchell in that position. As soon as we're doing interviews now, as soon as we hire that new position and get them trained as the Rabies Control Authority and come back, then they'll fill that position.
So I'd like to, again, nominate Dr. Brian Wade, Katrina Mitchell, and John Herzog. Terms to expire 12/31/16.
Is there a second? I have a motion and a second to appoint Dr. Brian Wade, Katrina Mitchell, and Jan Herzog to the Animal Shelter Advisory Committee. Terms to expire 12/31/2016. Any discussion?
Can we make a correction? The term for Katrina Mitchell is a one-year term.
2015. Okay. Okay. We'll amend that motion to say Katrina Mitchell's term expires 12/31/2015. You want to change that motion, Michael?
Yes, so
he did.
So
he changed that motion.
I did.
Second. And it's been seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Aviation Advisory Board.
Two of them have expired, and Mr. Ross in position three would like, no, I'm sorry. It's Hank Anderson would like to be in number two. Is that correct? Because in position three you had no term limit, but that's actually 2008 is Ross Little. I saw his at 2008, so that would be him term limited out. Would that be, you see that, Tracy? You have the no term limit on lines one and two, but Hank Anderson started in 2011. One and three, okay, good. Just didn't want to confuse you when I read any names. I had some recommendations. James Jackson's retired Air Force, and I know Steven Anderson was there before. He's actually retired now and full-time in the out on the base, so he's here full-time. He's a retired airport pilot as well, so. Air Force pilot. So I was going to re-nominate Jackson and Steph Anderson in those two positions and re-nominate Hank Anderson in. So we have two Andersons on there. So with position number one, Mayor, I'd like to nominate James Jackson. Position number two, Hank Anderson. Position number three, Steven Anderson. All for terms to expire 12/31/2017.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to appoint Steve Anderson, James Jackson, and Hank Anderson to the Airport Advisory Board, terms to expire 12/31/2016. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say aye. Same sign. Motion passes. Construction Board of Adjustment.
You guys want me to do that? Okay.
Yeah.
Mayor, on positions two and five, Carrie Ann Taylor in two, and number five, Clay Wages. They have one more year to serve, so I'd like their term to expire 12/31/2015, position two and five. On positions one, six, eight, 10, and 11, all of them wish to continue to serve for 3 years, so that would be number one, Casey Winborn, six, Leo Lane, eight, Eddie Holcomb, 11, or 10, Jeff Browning, 11, Danny Shine, all to expire 12/31/2017.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to appoint members to the Construction Board of Adjustment, as stated by Councilor Engel. Any discussion? Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Lake Wichita Revitalization Committee.
Everybody reappointed? Anybody want to put in 11 and 12?
Yeah, they're wanting to add a couple of alternates.
I didn't know if did they.
That I hadn't heard who they.
Okay.
I haven't received any info on that.
Okay, well then if they come up, I guess we can do it later.
Well, we can go ahead and reappoint.
All of them, yeah.
The original member, or those that are there, we can add the alternates at a later date if we need to, or we can, I'll just I'll pick two. Colby Huffman, young guy in this community, he's very involved. I think he'd be an asset on that as an alternate, so I'll nominate Colby Huffman to alternate one. Donna Rust to alternate two. Terms to expire 12/31/16.
The board's set to expire July 30th of 2016.
July 30th?
Because we did an 18-month extension, which put it in July.
So 30 or 31? 31 days. Anyway, 30.
Okay, I'm confused now. The alternates are going to expire in July?
I think all of them.
We've made that 18-month extension, so everybody gets 16.
So everybody goes to 16. Okay, I got you now. Okay, the two alternates, Colby Huffman and Donna Rust, to 7/30/2016. And Tim, you've nominated the other
others
for reappointment to 7/30/2016. Okay, have two nominations, so we need 2 seconds.
Second.
Okay. Have motions and seconds to reappoint the current members to the Lake Wichita Revitalization Committee, terms to expire 7/30/2016, and to appoint Colby Huffman and Donna Rust into the alternate positions, alternate one and two, terms to expire 7/30/2016. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. MPEC Advisory Board.
Mayor, in position four, I'd like to reappoint Rick Hatcher. In position five, does anybody have any put in there? I was thinking Andy Lee, but does anybody?
That's fine.
Okay. And in position five, Andy Lee, terms to expire 12/31/2016.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to reappoint Rick Hatcher to the MPEC Advisory Board, term to expire 12/31/2016, and to appoint Andy Lee to the MPEC Advisory Board, term to expire 12/31/16. Any discussion? Being none, all in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. We still got a bunch more. Park Board.
Two want to stay on it. Position number three, John Hershey.
One's off.
James Ball.
I will move to reappoint John Fritsch and Steve Garner to the Parks Board, terms to expire 12/31/2017, and to appoint into place three Jim Potts, term to expire 12/31/2017. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? I have a motion and a second to appoint as stated. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Planning and zoning.
Make a motion to appoint Jeff Browning.
To place one, to reappoint Jeff Browning, to reappoint Johnny Combs to place six, to appoint Anthony Inman from an alternate into place four. And then to appoint Shannon Rutledge Hopkins into place eight. Lastly, there's one more alternate position. I would nominate Tony Cowardin to place 11, which is the alternate, for positions to expire December 31st, 2016.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to appoint as stated by Counselor Hoover. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Tax Increment Financing District Number 2.
Ben Fowler is currently serving, desires reappointment. I would nominate him to serve on the TIF 2 board, term to expire 12/31/2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and a second to reappoint Chip Fowler, or Ben Fowler, same guy, to the TIF District Number 2 board, term to expire 12/31/16. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. TIF 3.
Mayor, and TIF 3, both people up for permanent are currently serving, Gail Natale and Kenneth Haney, and they desire reappointment. So I'd like to, in position 1 and 4, reappoint them in their position, term to expire 12/31/2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to reappoint Gail Natale and Kenneth Haney to the TIF District Number 3 board, term to expire 12/31/16. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Traffic Safety Commission.
Need to find someone for District 4 and District 5. District 4 term limited out, and District 5 is vacant. Safety Commission, position number 11, Victor Coker, and position 13, Carrie Ann Taylor. Reappoint for 2-year term, 12/31/16, expire. And that alternate transportation mode. Tracy, who is that a specific? It says their qualifications.
Yeah, it needs to be someone to represent an alternate transportation mode, and I had a recommendation from the Traffic Safety Commission for Brad Altman.
What's his alternate transportation mode?
I know he's bicycling, an attorney,
so maybe
I believe
that explains it.
I believe he was involved in bicycling.
Bicycling? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So he's the president of the bicycling club.
Brad Altman.
Okay, so district position, okay, continuing the nomination, in position 18, Brad Altman, for term to expire 12/31/2016.
Okay, what about?
15, 16 are going to have to stay vacant because we have no District 4 or 5 representatives on there.
Is that a mandatory requirement that somebody from a council district be appointed into?
As far as.
Okay.
Yeah, that's one of the requirements.
And just so you know, just the district, is it 5, that's been vacant for several years. It's just.
Okay. Okay, we have a nomination to reappoint Andy Coker, reappoint Carrie Ann Taylor. District 4, there's no applicants. District 5, no applicants. And then in position 18, the alternate transportation mode would be Brad Altman. All terms to expire 12/31/2016. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Veterans Advisory Council, at this time, well, there's a lot of applicants. Okay, we're going to pass this one till January. at the January meeting, we'll deal with this one. Water Resource Commission?
We have three expirations. I'd like to nominate Steve Smith, Michael Smith, and Kerry Maroney.
Senior or junior?
That would be senior.
Yeah.
And that would be expiration 12/31/2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, we have a motion and second to reappoint Steve Smith, Michael Smith, and Kerry Maroney Sr. to the Water Resources Commission, terms to expire 12/31/2016. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Wichita County, City of Wichita Falls Health District Board. These are all out of City of Wichita Falls appointments. So we'll move on to the next item, Zoning Board of Adjustments.
On the Health District Board, there is the one city appointment in position number two.
Registered nurse.
The registered nurse. And there's a staff recommendation for Diane Stewart.
Oh, I'm on the wrong.
I'll make the nomination. Okay. Position two for the Wichita County City of Wichita Health District Board. Put Diane Stewart, term to expire 12/31/2016.
I was looking at the wrong item. Sorry about that. Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and second to appoint Diane Stewart to the Wichita County City of Wichita Falls Health District Board, term to expire 12/31/2016. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Same sign. Motion passes. Okay. Have we done Zoning Board of Adjustments?
No.
Okay. That's next then. Zoning Board of Adjustments.
All right. Mayor, in position two, term limited out, I'd like to move up David Lane, term to expire 12/31/2016. In position four, move up the alternate Steve Lane, term to expire 12/31. I had entered 2015. Is it still 2016, Tracy?
That one should be.
I wrote it down.
Position four should be 16.
16, okay. So those two are 12/16. Position five, move up Mr. Larry Ash to fulfill the remaining term limit. And that one was 12/31/15. Am I correct? And position five. All right, then in position six, I pick Warren Garner, seven, David Waddle, eight, Casey O'Donnell, and nine, Tyson Traw. As the alternates, all to expire 12/31/2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to appoint members to the Zoning Board of Adjustments as stated by Councilor Engel. Terms to expire 12/31/16. All in favor?
Can you say those again? I'm sorry. I
position six, Warren Garner.
Okay.
Seven, Dave Waddell.
Okay.
Eight, Casey O'Donnell. Tyson Traw, the same.
Okay.
Okay. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Library Board.
Mayor, for the Library Board, place five is vacant. I would like to put in Carolyn Watt, and place seven is vacant, and I would like to nominate James Ball.
James who?
James Ball.
Oh, Jane.
And their positions would expire 7/30. Carol's Watt would expire 7/31/2017, and James Ball would 7/31/2015.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second to appoint a member to the library board. Nominated are Carolyn Watt, term to expire 7/31/17, and James Ball, term to expire 7/31/15. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion passes. The Housing Authority Board is a mayoral appointment, and at this point in time, there are no applicants for that position. It has to be a resident of the Housing Authority. So we will defer that one to a later date.